Good evening, and thanks a lot for inviting me to be here today. It's an honor, and really I much appreciate this presence to hear about the Palestinian political prisoners. Allow me to start with a very short film. It's not a documentary. It's just in order to reflect 50 years of torture in the memory of the 50 years of occupation that was prepared in this occasion this year. And then I will brief more about the Palestinian political prisoners.
When they torture your mother, plant a tree. When they torture your father, plant a tree. When they torture your brother and your sister, plant a tree. When they assassinate your leaders and lovers, plant a tree. When they torture you, too bad. Talk, plant a tree. When they begin to torture the trees and cut down the forest they have made, start another.
Actually, I wasn't surprised at all to be invited today to present the issue of the Palestinian political prisoners in the context of the Nakba and 70 years of the colonization of Palestine, and especially in Ireland, because I think the issue of political imprisonment actually is a very essential for people who live under colonialism. And we totally understand as Palestinians and an Irish what it means to be under such a regime of judicial regime, actually, that at the beginning it's there in order to present that we are a democracy, but it hides all the policies of oppression and control, because actually the imprisonment and mass imprisonment and arbitrary detention is the most powerful tool in the hands of the colonizers in order to control the whole society, and not just to control, but to affect the consciousness and to reshape the thoughts and beliefs and the life of the people under occupation. So under such a colonialist regime, the mass imprisonment becomes an aim by itself. And since it's becoming an aim, this is means that it's not, they don't develop all these orders and rules in order to maintain rule of law or public order, as they claim, but in order to control the society. So then, torture and arresting political leaders, assassinations, targeting activists, targeting union members, targeting women, children, all different members of the society becomes essential, becomes a need in order to maintain this system. Usually such practices starts in a very violent, brutal, primitive way of methods harsh physical methods of torture, and it ends up with a very sophisticated system that is very, in the surface, looks very democratic, but as I said, it's all about oppression and more and more restrictions and violations of basic rights. So today, I will bring just three stories of three female Palestinian prisoners which will reflect about the whole system, not just in the occupied territories, because it's very important to highlight that the issue of imprisonment as a policy, as a widespread policy actually, and a systematic violation started back in 1948 and continued after the occupation of the rest of Palestine in 67. So immediately after, like, the first case would be Darin Tatour, the Palestinian 48 poet that she's now facing prosecution because of her poem about the resistance that she published and shared in her Facebook account. Khalida Jarrar, a Palestinian political leader and a Palestinian parliamentarian that was subjected twice now for imprisonment, first under prosecution and currently under administrative detention twice for almost 1 year. And the third case is Ahd al-Tamimi, that I'm sure all of you know the case of Ahd, a Palestinian child that was arrested, imprisoned, because she dared to slap a soldier that invaded her house, while Elior Azaria, the Israeli soldier who assassinated and verified killing a Palestinian guy in Hebron, Sharif, he was sentenced for 19 months and he was released, early released last week, and he was awarded and welcomed as a hero in his community, where the Israelis pushed the Europeans to stop their fund to the Palestinian Authority because the fund is channeled through the Palestinian prisoners ministry that was canceled 2 years ago to the Palestinian terrorists, to the Palestinian prisoners actually. So in 48, immediately after the establishment of the State of Israel, the policy of mass imprisonment started. And just in 2 years, 48 and 49, the estimation that around 12,000 Palestinians were detained and arrested. And of course, then they were not prosecuted. The majority of these prisoners were held as prisoners of war, though most of them, they were not involved in the armed conflict or they were not holding weapons at all. But this was easier for the state to define them as prisoners of war in order not to deal with the length of the detention that they face. So they can lock up them for long times without being enforced to bring them in front of a judge or any procedures. Some of them, and the majority of them actually, were deported and enforced to leave the country under the claim that their families already, they were refugees. And some of them, of course, they were internally displaced after being released and found that their villages were destroyed. By the way, all the Palestinian community under 48 were under military control till 1966, which means there was a total military regime controlling the daily life of the Palestinian who became citizens of the State of Israel, including on the security level, I mean in the level of criminalizing all different activities that aim to resist, or even if it's not clear resistance, even being a political active in any group inside Israel was considered illegal because all such political initiatives were illegal, of course. And it's very important as well to remember that the Israelis in 48, they amended the British security regulations of 1945 in order to implement such security control over the population, because according to these security measures, any public resistance, any act could be considered by the military governor of the area as illegal and a cause for arrest, especially under administrative detention. And this was used in a very widespread manner in the 48 areas in the beginning, till, as I said, 66. And then later in the 70s, they amended these policies of administrative detention to be inside the Israeli criminal code, which means now they have in their own criminal code an article that enables them to arrest people under administrative detention. They still use it, but actually there's huge discrimination how they implement it against Palestinians in the occupied territories and against Palestinians and Israelis. We should mention that it was used against some of the Israeli right-wing settlers, but totally in a different manner than it's used in the occupied territories. Of course, the curse of Darin, like lots of things happened in the development of these systems in the years and where we are standing today inside Israel, I mean, when it comes for what so far they defined as security crimes, that this is the base for arresting Palestinians usually inside the state, that they are involved in any criticism or activism against the policies of the state. There's no space now to try to bring this history about the development of the laws, the practices, and also the court decisions. But it should be highlighted that there was a military court prosecuting such crimes up till the late 90s, like even after the Oslo Agreement, some Palestinians from East Jerusalem and citizens of the State of Israel were prosecuted under the military court in Elled and were subjected for military orders for security cases. What was significant change in 2015 was the new trend after, like, of course, founding this cyber unit that started systematically following every activity in the social media for Palestinian activists. Darin was arrested because of this poem that she published, where she was awarding her people uprising, because you remember in 2015, late 2015, after the burning of Abu Khdeir in Jerusalem and all the clashes that started, a kind of semi-intifada. We thought that it would continue, but it was lasting for a couple of months, but it caused mass arrests inside Israel, in East Jerusalem, and also in the occupied territories. And lots of actually social media activists were arrested, not just Darin. What was significant in Darin's case, like beside the fact that how come this poem becomes a threat and a cause for arrest, because the Google Translate that the police, one of the police officers decided to use Google Translation from Arabic to Hebrew, it was like misinterpreted, and it seemed like she's calling for violence, and it wasn't the case. So all the Darin was arrested at the beginning for custodial imprisonment of 3 months. Then she was released under house arrest. Darin was kept under, and she's still under house arrest for almost 2.5 years. While she chose to exhaust all the procedures, so they were bringing witnesses, including experts in translation from Arabic to Hebrew, and this was not a protection. She was convicted last week by the district court in Nazareth for incitement. Darin could be facing a sentence of a couple of months, maybe 1 year or more than 1 year imprisonment because of this poem that she shared in her social media. Other activists inside 48 areas were subjected for not just house arrest, other measures that included, for example, enforcing them not to reach Jerusalem, or if they live in Jerusalem, to leave Jerusalem to go to the other cities like Tel Aviv or Haifa to live for 6 months or 1 year. This is part of the practices that actually, beside the imprisonment, that they can implement in order to control your activism and to affect your daily life at the end of the day. If I want to compare or to tackle a bit about the discrimination, I would take more serious case than Dareen's, when in the 70s and the 80s, some of the Palestinian citizens were involved in more militant activities, for example. But still, there was a huge discrimination when it comes for sentences and procedures in the Israeli civil, not just between the Israeli military court and the civil system, even if they would be prosecuted in the same district court, whether in Jerusalem or in Nazareth or in Haifa. One of the cases is the case of Mukhlis Burghal, though he was imprisoned and sentenced in a military court. But Mukhlis was convicted with trying to throw a bomb that it never exploded, it never caused any injury, any damage, nothing. He was sentenced for life sentence. Life sentence for security cases in Israel is unopened. It's 100 years. It's not limited with 25 or 30 or whatever. Later on, his sentence was limited for 40 years. He spent more than 26 years, and he was released in 2011 in the exchange deal. Where other Israeli criminals who were convicted with killing and attacking Palestinians, like Ami Popper, for example, that killed seven Palestinian workers in the first Intifada, he was sentenced first for seven life sentences. Later, he was getting amnesty, and it was limited for 40 years. He was able to get house visits, like he was getting a vacation outside his, like outside the prison for 48 hours, 72 hours, or 3 days. And he got married while he's in prison and had a family, where Mukhlis was like 52 when he, around 50 when he was released, and he just has a baby like a couple of months ago, and a baby of, like he got married after being released. I'll move to the case of Khalida, and I choose the case of Khalida because it's highlighting the issue of arresting political leaders, the use of administrative detention, the use of military orders to control freedom of movement and forcible transfer, and of course the fair trial procedures and the other problems we face on our daily work in front of this military system. Before starting on the details of Khalida's case, like in 1967, Israel decided that this territory is not occupied. And they didn't apply the, at the beginning they, yes, applied the Fourth Geneva Convention, but very soon they said, no, it's not applicable. And of course, they started to implement their own military system. This military system was developed all these years. Nowadays, we have more than 1,700 military orders that actually control and interfere in almost every aspect of our daily life. It decides who can be a lawyer, like who can have access to the military courts still, even after the establishment of the Palestinian Authority and the fact that we have our own Palestinian Bar Association. And it's controlling the health, the education, the freedom of movement, housing, and land issues, and every aspect, as I said. So, by the years, they started, as I said, in very undeveloped system that basically was aiming to arrest and criminalize, but by the years, and it was like totally unfair trial. It was very clear. There was no appeal court, for example, in this military system till the 80s. The judges who sit in this military court was not lawyers. They were ordinary soldiers that they were serving in the army. One of the three judges panel was supposed to be with education, legal education. Again, he wasn't supposed to be a member in the Israeli Bar Association. It's enough if he studied law and never practiced as a lawyer or as a judge in order to prosecute hundreds of thousands of Palestinians. And this is how it was till actually 2004, 2005, when out of all this pressure and criticism coming from internal human rights NGOs and international human rights colleagues as well, when the Israelis started to develop this system and to change in the system and to make these changes, as it's mostly cosmetic changes, I would say. It's not giving any protection. At the end, it didn't change the level of unfairness in these military courts. So what happened with Khalida started with a military order issued in September 2014 by the military governor. Khalida is a resident in Ramallah city, to enforce her to move from Ramallah to Jericho for 6 months, based on secret information that she's causing a threat to the security. Which security? The security of the area, by living in Ramallah. When we challenged this order in the military court, of course, Khalida refused to obey the order, and she had a tent in the yard of the Palestinian Legislative Council, and she started her own campaign against this military decision. We appealed the order to the military court. Khalida wasn't present there as a political position, political saying as well. And when the judge was angry, like, how come she's not here, I said there's nothing in the military order can enforce her to be present. It's enough that she's represented by myself. And we argued, like, it's ridiculous. What would be the difference? You have to justify what's the difference in between Ramallah and Jericho. Both cities are under the Palestinian Authority jurisdiction. And I would claim, and I have a certificate from the Palestinian Authority, that for them, it's so, like, they cannot understand what's this and how you interfere in their decision. She's a political representative, and for them, she's not causing any threat in Ramallah. The judge didn't take decision. He delayed for another hearing, and in the same day, a couple of hours after, I'm getting a fax from the military governor office that the order was canceled. It was 1 month after the first initiative of the order. It was for 6 months. So it ended there. 4 months after, they raided Ramallah and they arrested Khalida from her house. They brought her for interrogation in Ofer detention camp, and then they prosecuted her. They faced her with 12 charges. All were about her membership in a political party, of course, but representing this political party in the parliament, and all of her parliamentarian work was listed in the charge sheet as crimes committed by her. 17 witnesses they brought, like it included mostly confessions of other prisoners that they were already released against Khalida, that she's a member in the Popular Front, that she shared in demonstrations in support of the hunger strike of 2012, that she was inciting in her speeches in the public demonstrations, and so on. So when we started to argue the case in front of the military court, it took us 8 months to hear 4 witnesses. 8 months of bringing Khalida every week to the court from Hasharon prison to the Ofer military court. The journey took more than 12 hours back and forth, where Khalida was taken out of the prison at 2 a.m. in the morning, whether it's cold, whether it's summer, no matter what, handcuffed, shackled, sitting in the bus, the posta, what we called it, posta, handcuffed and shackled inside the posta to the iron chair in the bus, and doing the tour where they collect other detainees, usually to bring them collectively to the court. So she was enforced to stay in the bus from 2 a.m. till 8:30 or 9 a.m. in the morning till they reached to the court without being able to use the bathroom, because they claimed the main facility they reach to concentrate all the prisoners, the Ramli facility, have no toilets for female prisoners' use. And I'm saying this as an example, of course, about all the other cases and the bad conditions that prisoners, it's not just Khalida that she, oh my God, 5 minutes. That Khalida face. So, and I'm bringing these details in order to figure how these 99% of prisoners reach a plea bargain end at the end of the day, and they refuse to argue their case in front of the court. Because actually, after getting such degrading treatment, after such long procedures that no one can guarantee that they would be acquitted or that they can get a fair trial or that they can be sentenced for a reasonable sentence. And in the case of Khalida, they were requesting 5 years imprisonment for these charges. Of course, they at the end, we reached a plea bargain, and they agreed to drop all the charges, but just to keep two, the membership and the incitement to kidnap soldiers to exchange. The only charge that they didn't have any proof in the evidences about. But this is what happens actually in a plea bargain. Because they believe that you have no other choice and you are tired and you want to put an end for this oppression, they push you to accept any offer from their side. And then Khalida was sentenced for 15 months. She was released in the 3rd of July 2016 to be rearrested in the 1st of July 2017. Exactly 1 year after her release, she was subjected for 6 months administrative detention, now based on secret information. And it was renewed. She was supposed to be released in the 1st of January 2018. She was renewed for another 6 months. There's no guarantee at all that Khalida would be released at the end of June. And actually, currently there's just 6 parliamentarians in the prison. But at some point in 2007, the Israelis arrested 48 Palestinian parliamentarians, more than the third of the Palestinian parliament members. And by this, they totally paralyzed and caused for actually that the parliament never convened fully. Okay, now it's not active at all, but I mean at the beginning, this was a serious cause for the whole political process in Palestine. Not mentioning, of course, that in 2005, 3 months before the election, they arrested 450 activists, Hamas and Islamic Jihad and Popular Front and other political activists 3 months before the election in order to affect the results of the election. Some of the Hamas representatives were elected while they were under administrative detention in the Israeli prison in 2006. This is what we mean by the use of imprisonment in order to control the whole life of the people. It's very important to highlight the fact of the administrative detention. Currently, there's 450 administrative detainees in the Israeli prisons. Since February 2018, the 15th of February, they are boycotting the Israeli military court procedures because they believe it's not doing any effect in this judicial review over the military orders. And can I get more 5 minutes? Please. From his. he will allow me 3 more.
Go ahead.
You haven't come to our head yet, so we have to.
So now they have a strike against the military courts because actually this court was not interfering in most of the cases in the administrative detention. And I'm sure you know all what it means to be under administrative detention, indefinite detention, that you will never know when you would be released, why you were arrested at all, because it's based on secret information. And of course, they used hunger strike, individual hunger strike, and massive hunger strike in the past, and it didn't affect it at all. Now they have planned as well to continue. Maybe they will end up in June in using hunger strike again against the policy of administrative detention, because I think as a lawyer, even in these 20 years, these were more like most of the most frustrating cases that I worked with, when you enter to the court and you have nothing to do. You know that you have nothing to do, but just on the psychological level to be there in order to support the detainee, because you, as a lawyer as well, you don't know what's written there in the secret file that you don't have access to and how you are supposed to defend yourself. Three children now, they are under administrative detention. Three women and three parliamentarians in these 450 administrative detainees. I will end up, and it's a pity that I didn't have enough time to talk about the child detention cases and the Ahad's case. But you should know that Israel, up till 2010, was prosecuting children in the same military courts under the same procedures as adults. In 2010, because of the international pressure, they invented this military court for juveniles, which was supposed to be offering more protection, but at the end, it ended up without any change on the reality of these children, whether on the level of torture and harassment and violations, on the process of the arrest. They are still arrested after midnight and tortured and brought to the detention facilities, interrogated without any legal counseling. Nir Ramati is here, and he, like, I don't know how many children he represented in these military courts, and he's, in most of the cases, he wouldn't be able, neither us as also Palestinian lawyers were able to meet these children, to give them counsel. It's very rare that we succeed to reach the detention facilities before they start interrogate them, and usually they interrogate them in the occupied territories after midnight, then prosecute them for throwing stones for 1 year, 1 year and a half. Sometimes if you're lucky and you are so young, like 12 or 13 or 14, you would be sentenced for 3 months. And as you monitored in Ahad's case, Ahad was also accused with several charges that included the slapping, throwing stones, incitement, and so on. But it should be highlighted that Ahad wasn't arrested alone. Her mother, Nariman, was arrested in the same case. They were just prosecuted separately because Nariman is an adult. And the mother was accused with incitement because she dared to distribute the video of her daughter slapping the soldier in the Facebook account. So both of them, they were at the end prosecuted for 8 months. In the court of Ahad, of course, when the attention and the international presence in the court reached a level where it was very embarrassing for the Israelis, the judge, Mr. Lieberman, decided to close the door in a claim that it's for the protection of the sake of Ahad as a child, where all the procedures from her first moment of arrest till that day, the sentencing, actually Ahad was... her picture was published in every media channel in Israel and outside, like in the international, and everyone knows her face and her identity and what she was doing. So it was so ridiculous and obvious that they had nothing as to like try to... I'm finishing. So just at the end, it's really very, very important to close by reiterating the importance of the international law and the use of these mechanisms. Because as a lawyer, I know that we failed to bring justice through the universal jurisdiction where we brought cases in the UK or in Spain against torture. Now we are trying to exhaust the jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court, and we are fully aware about the problems and the political pressure that we can face. We tried the PDS through the G4S campaign that Omar mentioned yesterday in relation with the issue of the prisoners. I think we shouldn't give up any of these tools that we have. Our strength is in our coordination and in our solidarity and in our support for all these mechanisms that we have in our hand as people. Thank you.